Okay, it's great to be back with you for another GoldSeek.com Radio Gold Nugget segment. Today's special guest, Professor Roger Tutterow from Mercer University's Stetson Business College. Roger Tutterow, Professor of Economics at Mercer University with a passion for economic modeling and forecasting. Welcome back, Dr. Tutterow.
Always nice to be with you, Chris.
You know, I'd like to begin, if we could, with the housing recovery. Given the Fed's QE operations with purchases, you know, of at least $1 trillion in toxic mortgage-backed securities and related debt, I mean, housing is obviously a vital component to this nascent economic recovery. And according to the St. Louis Fed's data, new housing starts have rebounded from the 2008 recession lows, but only to levels previously seen in the early 1990s. You know, in February, U.S. housing starts did decline. Analysts were blaming the cold weather as a culprit. In February, though, we have also seen sales of existing homes decline a bit on an annualized rate.
Yeah, clearly housing is continuing to rebound. The interesting point, though, is we have to put it in a larger context. And if you look from peak to trough, new home construction dropped on average by about 80% nationwide, some more in certain markets, particularly in the southeast and on the west coast. So one of the problems with dropping 80% is when you come down that far, you're going to have to grow for many, many, many years to get back toward normal. When I speak to business groups, I like to point out to them that when you drop 80%, you've got to go back up 400% to get back to where you were. And so even when you're adding 20, 25% gains per year, that takes a while. And to some degree, the big percentage changes we're seeing on the housing market are an artifact of working off that low base. Yes, housing is recovering, but it's going to take quite a while. And even when we get back to normal, that doesn't mean going back to 2003, 2005 employment levels, or I should say housing start levels.
Well, your track record for forecasting the sector has been impressive right here in real time on the show. And, you know, there's another economist with a successful track record, and that's Robert Shiller at Yale. He has, I think, a less sanguine outlook on the sector. Of course, he's maintained that, obviously, for at least 14 years now. Who's ultimately going to be proven correct here?
Well, I tell you, you got to give Professor Shiller credit for his track record. You know, first off, in the equity market back during the run-up in the latter part of the 1990s, he was actually the guy that coined irrational exuberance. And then again, in the housing bubble, he had provided a pretty good call on when he thought things were getting a little bit frothy. And then, of course, we're all familiar with the Case-Shiller Index itself, which is still probably kind of the gold standard for measuring how home prices have been doing. And we are seeing home prices come back, and almost all the 20 major markets are off their floors. But again, there's very few markets that are back to where they were at the peak, Dallas and Denver being two exceptions. Most markets have still some work to do to get back to where they are. I think that Professor Shiller is typically a little bit cautious, but I think that he probably has been proven right time and time again. And I think that we have to understand that when we talk about recovery in housing, we don't mean jumping back to what was really the fastest pace of expansion in my lifetime. We mean returning to something that's probably a little bit more sustainable.
That's well said. And, you know, Dallas, kind of an interesting scenario. When I talk to listeners, readers, subscribers in that town, I mean, we hear that they had quite a debt-related bubble in housing back in the 90s, and they learned their lesson, apparently, so they didn't take on quite so much debt. Another key metric Fed officials monitor closely, I think, is national unemployment. One of the best metrics, the weekly jobless claims, has declined to a three-month low, but, you know, we still see that stubborn unemployment, national unemployment rate ticking a bit higher. We're above the Fed's target, 6.5% rate. There's been a little bit of dissent among the Fed ranks here lately over whether QE operations are necessary. I'd like your thoughts.
Well, I think the Fed is probably trying to back away from that 6.5% threshold that they had set out, originally arguing that they would keep short-term rates at very, very historically low levels as long as rates stayed above 6.5% and provided inflation stayed well in check. I think that part of the problem is there's a recognition that the unemployment rate has dropped, but it's some part of that reduction is due to decreases in the participation rate. I don't think that you can compare today's reading in the mid to high sixes was what a similar reading would have been back in before the Great Recession. I think part of what the Fed's going to have to do is they're looking for a way to gradually work their way out the door in terms of bond buying, and then they're going to have to wrestle with how do they gradually remove the liquidity they pumped in the economy without dumping the bonds they picked up back on the market. And probably the last issue to hit is, of course, the policy rates, although certainly more recent Fed comments, particularly from Chairman Yellen last week, has probably woken some people up to the idea the short-term rates are going to come up earlier than some analysts were looking for.
You know, in February, the U.S. industrial output increased sharply, much higher than expectations. Manufacturing does seem to be a bit more robust here. I mean, it certainly accounts for a huge proportion of our industrial production here in the United States. Some are calling this the biggest gain in U.S. manufacturing output in over 6 months. I'd like your thoughts on how this might be important.
Well, we tend to see some volatility in the month-to-month readings on industrial production. About 85% of it is manufacturing, the balance being mining and utilities. Over the longer run, I am actually bullish on manufacturing coming back to our country. One of the reasons is that as labor costs have come up in Asia, we've started to see the differential between what it costs to produce here versus Asia starting to be squeezed. And that's exactly what modern economic trade theory would suggest, is that when you have free trade, you tend to get equalization of factor prices across countries. And I think that there have been a variety of academic studies over the last 24 months that say that more businesses are looking at reshoring production because that labor differential is becoming more compressed. That having been said, where a lot of the manufacturing gains are going to be, it will be in more capital-intensive production processes where the labor that is required for that will probably be a little bit of a higher skill set. So what is probably not racing right back is the manufacturing where low-skilled labor is able to command the kind of wages that they did maybe 20 years ago.
Interesting. Well, that's going to require a sea change, I think, in education in order to retool, you know, the intellectual capital required to fit that void there. Interesting. I also wanted to move on to the inflation numbers. CPI did increase a bit, but, you know, for the most part, it seemed to have been offset recently by the decline in oil and particularly gasoline prices. I mean, most of our listeners do have to pay the grocery bills each week, and this is where we're seeing substantial price appreciation. What are your thoughts here on the typical, the middle class, the working? Obviously seeing huge increases in insurance, education, food and related expenses. What do you think the Fed can do? Do they have ample wiggle room here to keep rates low, or eventually are they going to have to increase rates?
Well, at some point they will. I mean, and keep in mind that when we talk about cutting the quantitative easing or cutting the bond buying by $10 billion in a month, we're really just talking about taking it from $65 or $55 billion down. So we're still in a very, very accommodative monetary policy. It's hard when you're looking at a federal funds rate essentially at zero and you're still buying that many bonds after more than tripling the size of your balance sheet to call the current policy anything but accommodative. It hasn't shown up in terms of inflation yet, but also it's important to keep in mind that the earlier advocates for the idea that monetary expansion causes inflation, folks like Milton Friedman from the University of Chicago, would always point out that it's actually the money supply you keep an eye on. And for the most part, what has happened is as the Fed has raised the monetary base, we've seen the money multiplier move in the opposite direction. So while they have injected a lot of reserves in the banking system, until we really start to see all that show up as increased loans, it really isn't money supply and probably is not inflationary until that occurs.
We look at the banks that have received much of this stimulus-related money, and as I know most people know by now, they're not lending. I mean, they're holding on. They're either investing, my guess is, in T-bills or in highly risk-averse opportunities there. Essentially, that money seems to be tied up. What's it going to take to loosen the lending reins?
Well, you know, in defense of the bankers, a couple caveats. First, most of the bankers you talk to will tell you that they actually perceive there to be less loan demand than they would consider desirable. If you look at the Federal Reserve Senior Officer Lending Survey, certainly there's been some uptick in demand, but it really loan demand has been suppressed for quite a while because, candidly, businesses in particular aren't going to borrow money unless they are very confident that they can deploy it in ways that increase shareholder value. And so I think that one of the things to understand is when we don't don't see a lot of loan creation. Part of it may be on the supply side, but a good bit is on the demand side as well. And then the other supply consideration is the banks are still working their way through a new regime in terms of regulation. We're now wrestling with what the final implications of Basel III accords will be, whether banks will have to actually carry more capital, and they certainly will, but they're, in terms of the buffer, they're trying to figure out exactly how much extra capital they will have to carry going forward. And a lot of bankers are wrestling with issues about how they may have to estimate and reserve against loans in a way that they did not have to in the past. And this, essentially, we're still kind of working through some of those methodologies. So I think once you consider the new regulatory world in which the financial institutions are working and couple that with the fact that the loan demand from businesses and consumers doesn't appear to be too robust, I think it's pretty understandable why we haven't seen it show up completely in the loan numbers yet.
I'd like to know your stance on the Glass-Steagall Act. Many folks have pointed to it recently as the a major driving factor behind the 2008-2009 credit crisis, simply because the barriers that were put in place around the Great Depression that essentially kept our banking, our lenders, our major banking institutions from colluding with the investment side of the equation. We lost that barrier, and some folks are concerned that, that now that we've opened up that Pandora's box, it could lead to constant repeats of the 2008 credit crisis situation. Any thoughts?
Well, I think you're right in terms of the importance of breaking down Glass-Steagall. I mean, what it essentially had done for decades was segment the banking world between commercial banks and investment banks. When the Glass-Steagall came down the latter part of the 90s, it really did kind of blur that distinction in a significant way. I think part of the problem is, you know, and I'm torn on this one because I am a free market guy who believes that you have to have a very high threshold in terms of burden to put in place regulation to prohibits business activity. And the problem, though, is you've got an interesting situation in which the FDIC is insuring the deposits of Joe Q citizens and businesses at these institutions. And so the question becomes, do you want to allow institutions to benefit from deposit insurance at the same time that they're taking the kinds of risks, perhaps with their own capital, perhaps with some of their clients' capital, they take on the investment banking side? And I think that's really historically been the argument for supporting Glass-Steagall-type barriers. I think it would be very hard at this point to separate out the functions within the banking sector. So I think, you know, we're the early parts of trying to redefine how we separate commercial and investment banking activities, even within the same organizations.
Fed tapering was a major component, a big factor in the precious metals reaction over the past 2 years. I'd be remiss if I don't try to get your outlook and you try to find out what your models are saying regarding gold and silver. Now that tapering, I think, is factored into the markets, investors, they're shifting their focus away to the more traditional safe haven characteristics and inflation-related buffering characteristics of the precious metals sector. For instance, we're also seeing tensions between Western powers and Russia over Crimea. And according to a recent Telegraph report, there is the potential for a new Cold War unfolding there. I'd like to know what your models are indicating with regard to the precious metals, please.
I think, you know, over the long run, we believe that real assets, hard assets, which would include precious metals, tend to provide some hedge against inflationary pressures. I think also, though, in the case of a metal such as gold, you tend to see it serve somewhat as a safe haven. So typically in times, particularly of international crisis, you may see some flight toward gold. Over the longer run, though, I tend to believe that, you know, what it does is what most real asset prices do, which is that it moves in response to deteriorations of the value of the currency. And since we haven't, as of yet at least, seen a lot of inflation show up, particularly at the consumer level, I probably have not seen gold, you know, be flocked to quite as much as maybe it had, as some people had seen in the past. A lot of the run-up in gold probably had to do with rising concerns about the general health of the economy 4 or 5 years ago. We've given back some of the gains over the past 12 to 18 months, although it is still very much elevated versus where we were at pre-crisis levels.
Well, we want to thank you very much for your economic insights today. And I guess the best thing we can do is just try to direct our listeners and their progeny over to the Stetson Business School at Mercer University.
Do appreciate it, Chris. Always nice to be with you.